It was the volume all the way down.
Yeah, I could just hear myself talking, but I like couldn't hear the microphone.
The sound
I got
of
two turntables and a microphone. Where it's at? Oh, I got two turntables and a microphone. You don't know that one?
How did you know I didn't know that song?
Because you would have joined in.
Two turntables and a microphone. Where is that?
I got two turntables and a microphone. That's where it's at.
That's where it's at. That's what I always say.
One, two, three.
Hi, I'm Maggie.
And I'm Amanda.
And we're sisters.
In-law.
We're watching Suits one episode at a time.
It's a show so nice, I've watched it twice.
And a show so great, I'm watching it late.
Thanks so much for tuning in.
Maggie's never seen it, and Amanda's obsessed. They don't wear fancy suits, they are casually dressed. They are sisters-in-law, and they got a show about a law firm drama that aired a few years ago. Only Suits fans, only Suits fans. Only Suits fans, only Suits fans. Only Suits fans, only Suits fans.
This is season 4, episode 15, Intent, and season 4, episode 16, We Didn't Write It Down.
I actually
want to leave that in.
Okay, go, do it. I got it.
This is season 4, episode 15, Intent. And season 4, episode 16, Not Just a Pretty Face.
Nailed it. I'm coming back.
I'm coming back. Guess who's back?
Back again. Maggie's back. Okay.
Tell a friend.
Episode 15, I thought, how can we get any more dramatic than this?
But we did. We just watched the season finale together.
We did. It was beautiful.
I fell asleep twice.
You did. You know, it wasn't one of those high energy finales.
No, and I wasn't high energy because we started watching it at 9:45.
We did.
Yeah, so we're having a late night tonight. You thought I wasn't going to be awake.
I didn't think you were going to be awake, but I didn't know I was getting like
this
slumber party Amanda.
This
like
is slumber party
fighting Amanda. Being the first one to fall asleep Amanda.
Fighting it real hard, you know what I'm saying? Thinking about much. I got two turntables and a microphone.
Oh my gosh.
But I still know what's going on.
You know what's going on. And it was a good episode. I was captured.
You were encaptured?
I was encaptured, enraptured.
Yeah. And also laughing.
I did laugh several moments.
Several times.
Yes. Okay, I'm going to read my brief. Before I read my brief, This Week Another Podcast came out.
Yeah, do you want to talk about it?
Sidebar?
Yeah.
I didn't quite listen, but I want to because I love Patrick J. Adams and I love Sarah Rafferty.
We've been waiting for this for like a long time.
And I love Suits and they are from Suits and yes. They are doing a podcast about Suits.
I have listened to it.
Yes.
And I have notes.
Yes.
Not notes for them, but like I can give you the Cliff's notes.
Yeah, give me the Cliff notes.
Well, first of all, they're great.
Obviously.
I don't want to say that like maybe their production value is higher than ours.
What?
So I'm not going to say it.
Don't say that. Don't discredit this.
Huh?
Don't discredit this.
I'm not. That's why I'm not going to say that.
Yeah, good.
So it's interesting. So they did the pilot and it was a little over an hour, but they didn't get through the pilot. So they did part one of the pilot. To be fair, if you remember, the pilot is a movie.
A movie. It was very long.
Yeah. I think what's interesting about their podcast, despite the fact they're both like excellent hosts, is that they just know all. They know
everything
that happened. Also, they haven't watched it.
They're like me.
They're like you.
They don't know what's going to happen.
You couldn't be more like anybody than you are like Patrick J. Adams and Sarah Rafferty, honestly.
I'm the same. I'm them. They are me.
Same thing. So they're watching it for the first time and then talking about it.
Are they making predictions? Because they don't know.
They don't make predictions because that's something that we do is that, you know, we always hop on that train to prediction town. They don't make predictions
right.
because they were there. And they, to be fair, they had the script.
Mm-hmm.
What they do is something that we also do. Which is a brief.
Of course.
They do a brief.
Of course. We're geniuses.
And they're like, well, if we're going to do something, let's do what the geniuses are doing.
Let's do what the geniuses are doing.
Right?
Yeah. Are their briefs as briefy as ours or more boxery?
Well, that would mean it's a type of an award that we give Maggie.
Right. So should we start giving briefies, including sidebar briefs?
I was thinking that we would throw in some of their briefs in just see. Like next season. Like we can go, mm-hmm. you know, and say. So what their briefs are actually brief.
Oh, what? It's like a log line?
Basically, it's exactly what it is. It's okay. Like, it's not as long as ours. I will say they're going for more like accuracy when we are probably injecting some more humor into it. So,
well, speaking of humorous briefs.
Do you have one?
No, I've got a very serious one that okay. I'm going to share.
Well, great. Then that'll be in line with what we heard on Sidebar.
Wonderful. Yeah. I'm sure.
Honestly, I'm learning a lot about that show, which I thought I knew so much about it, but like I'm learning even more.
We're going to have to do this podcast again.
Yeah, I was thinking we might have to do a podcast re-listen of their podcast, which I think would be really fun.
Recap, Sidebar the podcast, the Suits podcast, a Suits podcast about the Sidebar Suits podcast.
Yes.
I'm into it. Okay, here's my brief. Fortsman's back, Cahill's back, District Attorney Terrence Wolfe's back, and Mike has to go back to Joe Whistleblower to tell him the firm blew up the deal. We're flashing back to end season 4, but not before Jessica loses Jeff Malone for good, and Harvey says he loves Donna while walking out of her apartment. But first, Donna faces prison time. Harvey and Mike face off with smoking hot lady attorney Evan to break some rules and get Donna out of prison, and Mike faces Rachel in a sea of candles and gets down on one knee to propose. Meanwhile, Donna proposes that she is done with Harvey and on to the next best thing. Lewis Litt! How will this unfold in season 5? I cannot wait to find out.
That's great, Maggie.
Thank you.
You wrote that just now.
Basically a log line.
It's like if you were trying to build a cabin and you needed a real thick log for the base, like you needed a sturdy base.
Oh, yeah, sturdy oak.
Sturdy oak. Yeah. You're like the Paul Bunyan of log lines.
I am. I'm the Paul Bunyan of log lines.
You know what? We should give out a Paul Bunyan award to the briefs, and it's like the one who writes the sturdiest brief.
This brief is like a brief that could hold a huge log in it.
Yeah.
So before the credits, we see Mike at the bar with Joe the whistleblower, and they're celebrating. Mm-hmm. They're like, we got this. A thing like this can really turn your life around.
Yeah, no kidding.
Foreshadowing, because it's not going to work out. Then we see Harvey, who got a haircut.
Mm-hmm. I think he got a haircut.
I think he might have gotten a haircut. Mm-hmm. He's waiting outside Donna's apartment to confront her about being what he calls an idiot. Mm-hmm. He calls her an idiot.
Which is like, dude, don't do that.
That's harsh. Donna. That's Donna.
It's also a human.
An really. Idiot's so strong when you're saying it in a serious way.
Yeah.
It's very off-putting.
Yeah.
But he thinks that this was all Mike's idea, to have Donna sneak in, pretend to be someone. And Donna's like, I didn't do anything wrong. Get off my case. Stop thinking I'm an idiot.
She's got a great coat on in this scene.
They all have really nice coats.
Oh, my God, I love their outerwear.
Their outerwear. I love who they are on the inside, but also their outerwear.
Yeah, we love it.
Rachel and Mike are also celebrating mm-hmm. with some celebratory sex.
Yeah, it's sex.
She's so proud of him. Mm-hmm. Like, oh, I'm so proud of you. Mm-hmm. But then look who's knocking. Daddy Harvey is at the door. Mm-hmm. And he is there to blow this whole thing up. Mm-hmm. He's like, you gotta drop the case because I care about Donna and Donna's about to get in big trouble if we don't drop this case.
Yeah, she's in big time trouble.
Big time. That's big right. time prison time trouble.
Like, she's gonna go to the J-A-I-L.
The jail.
Yeah, the jail. The prison.
Prison, jail.
Yeah. Behind the bars.
Behind the bars.
Mm-hmm. Not in front of them.
And all that happens just before the credits.
Yeah.
Then we hear our favorite song. We see Harvey, because he's there to see Jessica. Mm-hmm. She is in her own condo. Mm-hmm. It is stunning.
How much money do you think that cost?
That one? Mm-hmm. In New York? Mm-hmm. $12 million.
That's what I was guessing, between 10 and 15.
Yeah. Oh, really? You were guessing that? Mm-hmm. I feel pretty good about my guess, then.
Yeah.
Because you're a realtor.
Yeah. That's legit. It's almost like, did you guys run out of hotel to film that? That lobby? That can't be really her condo.
Yeah, well, it can't be really her condo because she's a fictional character.
That's also true.
But, yeah. Okay. They're having drinks because of the Malone woes.
Yeah. I do want to note that she has on, like, some kind of black robe or something. Like, I don't think that's her black dress from work.
Yeah.
I think she is now into, like, her what some of people call a house coat.
Yes.
I call it a robe.
Uh-huh.
And I noted that while this is filmed many years ago, it looks exactly like the black robe I have from Amazon.
Wow.
Yeah.
I noticed
Make sure to swipe up.
I noticed it was not a Harvey Specter School of Law robe.
It's not. I have two black robes. So yeah. This Harvey Specter School of Law, which you can find at onlysuitsfans.com, is definitely an original. And I was talking to my friend Jessica about it the other day. Like, the silk robe is...
It's great. It's great. Fabulous.
This is just a more... it's like an everyday robe, you know?
Yeah. Like, you would drink red wine in it and not worry about...
Yeah, I would never... I would be so nervous to spill on the Harvey Specter School of Law.
Yeah, that's more like I'm luxurious. I just got out of bath.
Yeah, I'd have to have a clear cocktail.
Yes, for sure.
Yeah.
Lewis can't find Norma.
He's pissed.
He's at the office. He's so mad.
Which, by the way, we just never see Norma.
We never see Norma. And I, oh my gosh, the next episode. Yeah. Okay, and Donna's like, hey, back off the bash train. And Lewis is like, you always get on the Norma bash train. Something must be very wrong.
Right.
Turns out something is wrong because Evan's not going to drop the charges against Donna, even if Mike and Harvey drop the case. She's like, no, 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 son. I'm not just trying to win this case. I'm trying to get you where it hurts, and you're, like, obsessed with your secretary, and now you're going to know what it feels like to come at me.
Yep.
Like, she's biting big.
Oh, yeah. She's woof, big woof. Bite. Woof, woof. She's a big dog.
She a big dog.
Who let that dog out?
Woof, woof, woof.
Evan Smith let the dog out.
Woof.
Then Mike is telling Joe, the whistleblower, that they have actually lost the case. Turns out we had a little false beer celebration earlier. The case has been lost. And then Mike tries to turn it around on him and say that you weren't a credible source, which is like, yes, that is true,
but
that is not the reason why. I mean, I guess both things can be true, but that is not the reason why this case is not going to work. So
yes.
Joe's not happy because he was about to have his life changed, and now it's back to being a regular old Joe.
And Mike won't explain it either.
No, he just like walks away. He's like, it's over, Joe, which is kind of like a chicken shit move.
Yeah, and Joe's like, just tell me what happened.
Yeah.
And Mike's like, he wouldn't get it, blah, 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 blah.
Right.
So Jessica then goes to visit Jeff Malone in the office because he has not quit.
No, he has not quit.
He's still working for the firm. And she wants to talk about their relationship, but he's kind of like, what are you doing? I don't know what I'm going to do.
Give me some time. I don't know.
Yeah, he's just like, get out of here, kind of. Like, give me some space to calm down. And then we see Harvey telling Donna that he is going to do whatever he has to do to get Terrence Wolfe, the DA, to back off of Donna.
Which we haven't seen Terrence in a while, but if you remember, things didn't go well with Terrence several seasons ago. So it's kind of foreshadowing, if you have a memory, that, you know.
He does not like Harvey.
Yeah, he's a wolf.
He is a wolf.
Yeah.
In wolf's clothing, too. Not even in sheep's
clothing. Yeah, absolutely.
So Mike is really sad about having to have this conversation with Jim, the whistleblower. But despite all of it, he does not blame Donna for what she did, even though she's kind of the reason that this whole thing blew up. He actually blames Harvey. And Donna's like, don't blame Harvey. He's going to fix it. He says he's going to fix it, so he's going to fix it.
Yeah. I made a note here that she walked in when Rachel and Mike were talking about this. And she goes, oh, you didn't realize I was still on the hot seat. And she said, on the hot seat. And it's in the hot seat.
You're in the hot seat.
Mm-hmm.
You're not on the hot seat.
Yeah, but they said on the hot seat.
Do you think Donna said that wrong? Or do you think that Carl, the writer, wrote it wrong?
I think Carl wrote it wrong and somebody didn't have the heart to correct him. Which brings me to my first deposition. Is there a saying or something like that out there that you said wrong for a while? And then when you figured it out, you were like, oh, dang. Thanks, Carl. Besides, obviously, lawyer.
I'm sorry, what did you say?
Yeah, you call it lawyer, but we know it's lawyer.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, it's lawyer. Well, so one that I just thought of that I did not say, but I've said, listen, I say dumb things all the time. You could roll footage of this podcast and hear a bunch of dumb things I say. But I was a core member in Teach for America, right? And it's core, but it's spelled C-O-R-P-S. And it used to drive me crazy when people would be like, oh, you're a corpse member.
And it's like, I'm not. No, I'm not dead.
I'm a core member. The yeah. P is silent.
Oh, okay. And it's not C-O-R-E. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, that's how you say it. But it's got
drive me crazy, too. That's something to learn, you know?
Yeah. Reese's Pieces.
Oh, no.
It's Reese's Pieces. I used to say Reese's Pieces, and then someone was like, it sounds like feces. So yeah. I have a bunch.
Yeah, and eventually you'll be able to switch to lawyer, so you'll think of it.
Do you have
Googling
one?
Words? Yeah, I have a couple. These are actually not sayings, but words that I was saying incorrectly, and now I have to like think hard about it when I say it.
Mm-hmm.
I used to say Philadelphia, but it's Philadelphia.
The city?
Uh-huh. Yeah, no. The cream cheese.
I thought maybe it was like only this cheese.
No, the cream cheese Philadelphia. Is also named... Yeah, is named after the city, so I think they would be... They're spelled the same way. I said Philadelphia instead of Philadelphia.
That's cute, though. I like that as a name.
Oh, Philadelphia?
Yeah. I love that name, Philadelphia.
Oh, yeah. Maybe I'll go as Philadelphia for Halloween. Then the other one I was reminded of, not because... These people knew it, but I was in a conversation about the word pamphlet, and I used to say pamphlet.
Oh, that's cute.
Mm-hmm. Pamphlet. Mm-hmm. Terrence Wolfe and Harvey, speaking of them, felony fraud is the charge that they gave her, right?
Mm-hmm.
For Donna. Harvey is so pissed at Donna.
Yeah. Because she told him she did nothing wrong,
right?
And turns out she did.
She did, but remember I said in the last episode, she actually didn't say that she worked for the National Transportation Safety Board or whatever.
Right.
Or National Safety, whatever.
But it was heavily implied.
It was heavily implied.
And they have a witness who says she did. She did.
Well, but the witness wasn't listening. She needed to be a better active listener. She was too busy trying to catch some corn on Farmville. Do not know if you catch corn on Farmville, but she might.
She might have been.
She might have been catching corn.
Yeah, and Donna's like, I just wanted to be a hero.
Yeah.
You guys are always doing things. I finally did something, and
everybody said I saved the day.
Which is interesting, because I feel like Donna is often praised as the hero mm-hmm. in situations, but I guess she's just looking for a little more.
Yeah.
She's looking for a little more here. Yeah. Mike has been waiting outside of Joe's apartment, and Joe is not happy to see him, even though Mike's like, actually, I can take your case on again.
Mm-hmm.
Mike sniffs this out pretty quick. Liberty's already got him and paid him off.
Yeah, which is not good.
No.
Up next, we see Jessica. She is out to dinner with her sister. And you noted this is incredible casting.
Incredible. Like, she walked in, I was like, oh, that's Jessica's sister.
Yeah, it was great. Which, first time we've seen her.
First time I've ever seen her. They didn't even mention they were sisters until they halfway through the conversation.
Mom or dad, yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I was like, clearly.
Yeah, they're talking about, sis is giving her the tough love about Jeff Malone, right? Said if you didn't cheat on him, steal from him, or kill somebody, you should be able to work it out.
Once again, we are always using kill somebody
As a reason, yeah.
As the, like, only reason possible that someone could be doing something wrong.
Right. Mike tells Harvey that Joe is a no-go because, obviously, Liberty bought him out. And Harvey tells Mike that Donna lied. And Harvey then blames Mike because he's like, you knew about it. And Harvey's like, well, I wouldn't have... I knew where they came from, but if I would have told you they came from Donna, you wouldn't have listened. So now they're, like, trying to figure this out.
They're mad, but then they're thinking... They're
mad, like, okay, we could be mad. We can split hairs over this, or we have to, like, figure this out, right?
Mm-hmm.
So there are five elements to prove fraud, and they can't prove that damages were caused, because the thing is, then that would mean Evan has to reveal what was in those folders. Like, that's damaging material, and she's not going to want to do that.
Right. It's kind of a gotcha moment.
Mm-hmm. And so then...
Also, this feels wrong, though, because I feel like clearly... You can't do that, and there is damaging information. Anyways.
I know, but it's the law. So then Harvey runs on down to see Terrence and drags Evan in there and gives him the biz. Here's the deal. And they said, but there's intent. And Harvey goes, what you don't know about me is that I used to work at the DA's office, and never in the history of any case has a DA ever decided to go forward with just intent when it comes to on a felony fraud charge. And then
so
we find out that's not going to be the case.
Yeah. There's a first time for everything.
There really is.
But before we hear about that, Lewis is doing copy room work, and Donna tells him that Harvey took care of everything, and Lewis is so emotional. He breaks down. He finally has a moment to, like, think about the possibility of Donna behind bars.
Yeah.
And they have a huge hug.
Yeah, they have a hug.
They're besties.
Mm-hmm.
And then Mike is trying to find another client to go after Liberty with because he cannot use Joe. Mm-hmm. He snaps at Rachel, who is just trying to help. And then she's like, hey, why don't you talk to him? And points to a name in the folder.
Yeah.
Who is this him?
Well, we're going to find out. Donna is back to normal. She's filling Harvey in and thanks him when Terrence walks in to deliver a piece of paper, which happens to be her arraignment for the next morning, because he has amended the charges for intent and decided he would go ahead and like make an example out of this. Terrence says a crime was committed and he will find out who sent her in when she's about to be convicted, because Terrence is convinced that Harvey sent her in. So
even though Harvey will offer her
a deal. Going to offer her a deal so she can say, Harvey sent me in. Because he's going after Harvey. Everybody's going after Harvey.
Everyone's going after Harvey. No one likes Harvey. The jail time is 3 to 5 years for this.
Yeah. Which is, you know, I guess my question is like, what were you doing 3 to 5 years ago?
Having kids having both times.
Both times
I was postpartum.
Yeah.
Yeah. 3 years ago and 5 years ago.
Can you imagine? Like that whole span of time?
And 7 years ago.
Yeah.
It was weird to have an odd year and not be pregnant.
Yeah, last year was your first odd year to not be pregnant.
Yeah.
Because you got married, and the next one you got pregnant, had a kid.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. 15, 17, 19, 21. Mm-hmm. Then 23 was like...
It was chill.
Yeah.
Yeah, definitely chilling. I was over there tonight, like y'all were chilling.
Well, it's 2024 now.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay.
Lewis is distraught about this. And by distraught, I mean he's like, actually, I should be your lawyer. Get Harvey out of the equation. This is clearly like they're coming at you because of Harvey. Donna decides she's going to stay with Harvey because he says, I'm going to do this. I'm going to win this. Oh, and Donna turns to Lewis and says, I know that you want to help, but just go.
Another deposition.
Oh.
What would you do?
In this situation?
If you're Donna?
I think I would stick with Harvey because he has a better track record of actually winning.
Mm-hmm.
Then I would, yeah, I think I would stick with him.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, his track record on the show is pretty good.
Yeah.
For winning.
Yeah.
But also, he's digging a lot of holes.
Yeah. It's like once another option is like entered into the equation, it's like, oh, I hadn't thought about Lewis representing me, but that like...
Right.
It's like, for example, with fantasy football last night, I was like, what do I do about these tight ends? Like, do I drop my tight, like, do I swap my tight ends? Because then I'd have a tight end and a wide receiver on the same team, which Kyle, my brother, your husband, pointed out. He's like, hey, you got to think about this. Only one person can catch the ball
right
at a time.
Right.
So I made a gutsy move.
And did it pay out?
Yeah, it did.
Yeah, it did.
I mean, we won't completely know until Sunday. We'll have to see
how the tight end performs. But you did,
it was good. Yeah.
Yeah. Get it. Tidy.
Mike
and Rachel go to see that guy who was on the paper that Rachel pointed to, the him. It's actually a former mechanic who has become the fall guy for Liberty Rail. Mm-hmm. He thinks he is the one who killed everyone, and he is just so grateful to Liberty Rail for paying his pension, even though he's a huge mass murderer.
Mm-hmm.
He's like, oh my God, this guy doesn't even know. And Mike is like, I can guarantee a victory if you're my client, which feels like a big promise to make.
Right?
Yeah.
Yeah. Then we see the arraignment.
All rise.
And it's the state versus Donna Paulson. Can you imagine sitting there hearing those words?
I hate it.
So they decide to go ahead and go forward with the trial. She pleads not guilty. It's going to happen on Monday. And then Harvey's like right up in Terrence's face. And like, it's a very slow-mo. And Donna's kind of like seeing her court life flash before her eyes.
She can't even hear what they're saying. She can just see that it's heated. And it's not sitting well with her.
No. It's not.
Speaking of not sitting well, Jeff Malone is staring out the window of the office. And Jessica has made up her mind. She is there to tell him that she loves him.
Yeah.
And she's letting her walls down.
Yeah.
She does not kiss him when she leaves.
Well, it's more of a business transaction.
Even though, right, which is her problem, right? She's business transactioning her dropping her walls down. Yeah. And it's, if she's in the office, she is in the office.
Yeah. And that's just a factual statement, because if you're in the office, you're in the office.
Right. But she's like, mentally, I am here. Yeah. And it is here where I physically am.
Yeah. So then Donna goes to talk to Harvey. And she's like, maybe Lewis was right. You know, she doesn't like him pouring gas on the fire with Terrence Wolfe. And he calls her the enemy because she doesn't think he can win, which like it's such a harsh jump to make.
Yeah, he's such a boxer. He's like takes that leap.
He is a boxer. So Harvey goes to Mike and he says, I need all the help you can get. I don't need a start. I need a finish. He needs the records. And Harvey is going to probably obstruct justice.
Yeah, he's out there to obstruct justice for because Donna in the name of Donna. Mm-hmm. That he's like, I will win by any means necessary if it involves Donna. Mm-hmm. And he's willing to do some seriously shady shit.
Yeah, he is.
So we see him walking up the stairs to Joe's apartment, mm-hmm. and he's like, I'm going to hurt you. I'm going to beat your ass, basically.
Right.
Because if just the money is the issue, and that's why you're not talking, because Liberty gave you money, I will handle it. I'll pay you.
Yeah, I'll pay you. Seriously.
I'll pay you. Whatever they gave you, I will give you. Mm-hmm. But you need to still go after them.
Yeah, because as Harvey said, there's somebody out there who will always pay more.
Mm-hmm. And that's what he tells Evan when they meet with her. Mm-hmm. They're not just like coming after that. They're also coming after Evan. So they've used her move to come after Harvey with Donna against her.
Right.
So they're like, you're the one who's making all these shady deals. And then basically they make her have to obstruct justice.
Yes.
Then her hands are dirty. Mm-hmm. She has to go and like clean up this mess.
Yeah. And she says, you're going to let us get away with murder for your secretary. And he's like, yeah, and I'd do it again.
Jeff Malone puts in his notice, and they end with good luck.
Oh my gosh, it's such a sad sack ending to a relationship.
So sad. Good luck.
Ugh. Yeah, I wish you the best of luck.
Ugh.
Woof.
They're in the office, though, again. Yeah.
It literally and figuratively in the office.
Harvey and Donna are just laughing in her apartment.
They're drinking wine. They're reminiscing about some dinner party that they always talk about that happened there. And Donna's wearing some lovely pajamas. They're a little revealing.
Yeah, they're very casual with each other.
So yeah, they're very casual. And he was like, you know, if anybody else ever doubted me, it's fine. But with you, it's different. Like when you lose faith in me, it's different. Mm-hmm. And then he's like, I should go. And then she says, why? And then he gets up and he turns around and Mazzy Stars, Fade Into You is playing in the background. It's like the cliche song to play in this moment. And he goes, you know I love you, Donna.
This left me feeling like, dang, their relationship is kind of cute and also kind of fucked. Mm-hmm. Like it's adorable and also traumatic. Mm-hmm. I'm also going to be very mad if Jeff Malone messes with Jessica. I also felt like the whole thing with Evan, like a lot hinges on her obstructing justice.
So you worried she's not going to do it?
I was worried she wasn't going to obstruct justice.
Okay.
But I don't know. And she also now knows what Harvey's number is. Like she's like, okay, literally if I ever need to twist you into a bind, I will just do something to Donna. Mm-hmm. He's really shown his weakness. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm, mm-hmm. But that's not the end of the season.
No, but end of the season we watched tonight, like we spoke about.
Just moments ago.
Peeled off that couch.
I cannot believe that this ends with a flashback. Thank goodness. Because I love the flashback.
Yeah, because you looked over, you go, wait, is this a flashback?
Yeah. As soon as the first flashback happened. Yeah, yeah. And Whitney.
Yeah, our friend Whitney was friend watching Whitney. It and she goes, yeah, you could tell by the comb over.
Yeah, by the way he parts his hair, Harvey Specter. Oh. And I was like, oh, you're right. Because normally I rely on that green filter.
It's not as green.
And Donna's bangs. But I haven't really noticed Harvey's hair is significantly different as well.
Yeah, it's different. But it's not as green because they're in that bar. Mm-hmm. Which is a little bit more orange.
Yes. Mm-hmm. So we start before the credits. Harvey's leaving Donna's apartment. It just picks up right where we left off.
Yeah.
They have a song.
Sing, won't you sing for me? Is that how it goes?
I don't remember. It's an acoustic guitar strumming a song. Mm-hmm. And then it just seamlessly transitions into a flashback with mm-hmm. everyone cheersing Harvey at the bar. He's just won his first case. And Donna is there to be like, I'm here to celebrate you. Also, why is this the first case you've taken to trial? Because mm-hmm. it gets your name in the paper. I want to work for you because I'm an actress. Mm-hmm. She is Donna-ing hard.
Oh, for sure. And then Fortzman is also there, and he sends over a Macallan 36, which Harvey's only drinking a Macallan 18. He sends over a Macallan 36. And Harvey's like, nah, dude. And he goes over to hear what Fortzman has to say, and he was up against Fortzman. And Fortzman wants to give him a job, throwing out another one of those $1 million signing bonuses like he does.
Just willy-nilly throwing them down.
Ain't no big deal.
We also see Sean Cahill is waiting in the office in the middle of the night for Harvey because mm-hmm. he needs Harvey's help.
Yeah.
They cannot find Fortzman's money.
It's Woodall's money. They can't find Woodall's money that Fortsman has given.
Gave him. Yeah. Right. They can't find the trail from Fortsman to Woodall.
But they've
got to
find it with Woodall.
Mm-hmm. Yes. They're looking everywhere and they can't find it.
Mm-hmm. Harvey goes over to Mike and Rachel's to tell Mike that Cahill can't find the money. Rachel opens the door and she's like, he's like, you look different. And she was like, I've been pretty much invisible since, you know, Mike came back. It's just like a weird confrontation.
I mean, I thought he meant because she was in her casual clothes.
Yeah, he did. But then she
took it.
She took it like she had been invisible since Mike came back.
Right. Which I, whatever.
That's Rachel.
That's Rachel for you. That's Carl, the writer's version of Rachel.
Yeah.
So Harvey knows that the money went to someone Woodall cares about, which means they are going to have to figure that out.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so let's do all of the things that happened in the flashback first.
Yeah, let's do that. Mm-hmm. So, like we said, Harvey and Fortsman are meeting. He tries to get him to work for him. He says, thanks, but no thanks. Mm-hmm. Then Harvey goes to see Marcus, his little brother, and Marcus wants to open up a restaurant, and he needs $150,000. And he needs to borrow this from Harvey. And Harvey's like, I make $50,000, like, right now. As a deal. Like,
yeah, it's sorry. Not good money.
Yeah, it's not good money. Marcus says, if you don't give it to me, then I'm going to go see Mom, which means that man, which is the man that her mother cheated on their father with.
Right. And Harvey's like, you will not take money. I will figure this out.
Mm-hmm.
Which means he goes straight to Jessica. Mm-hmm. And he wants to move up the timeline to come back to the firm that mm-hmm. Jessica works at.
Right.
And she's like, this is because of Marcus. He must have done something and lost a lot of money. And he's like, no. It's a second chance. He's turning his life around.
Mm-hmm.
And she's like, no. And then he goes, okay, I'm going to go take a job with Fortsman.
Yeah.
And she gives him the exact same advice he gave to Mike
and
years
that Lewis
later.
Gave to Mike. I mean, like, everybody knows. Everyone do said. Do not get into bed with Fortsman.
Right. And Harvey's like, well, I'm going to because I'm going to help my brother.
Right.
I don't want him to take money from this stepdad.
Mm-hmm.
So Harvey goes and he visits him because he knows exactly where he lives, even though Harper Fortsman's like, no one knows where I live.
Right.
It's a house with a ton of columns and a very big fancy stairway.
It's so, such an interesting house. It's kind of not what I would picture him in.
Very what Greco-Roman?
Yeah. Uh-huh. It's just like they found a random house up in Toronto and they're like, hey, can we use your house today to film like one scene?
Yeah, I would picture him in more of like a modern, sleek situation.
Mm-hmm. I did too. Mm-hmm. Like a much bigger version of like Harvey's apartment.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
That's what I thought.
Harvey is so open and honest with Fortsman immediately about why he wants the money, why he's taking the job, about his little brother who has a gambling problem and he needs $150,000.
Man, he gives him all the deets.
Gives him all of it, like literally, immediately.
He handed over the entire pitcher of tea.
Yes. It's like he poured the pitcher of tea all over his body and then he was wearing a white shirt and Fortsman saw his nipples. That's how transparent he is.
You just took the words right out of my mouth.
First of all, Harvey blames himself for Marcus's gambling addiction.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Because we know Harvey is a gambling man, but he's like, if you always win, it's not a problem.
Mm-hmm.
And clearly Marcus does not always win.
Mm-hmm.
This leads Fortsman and Harvey to make a little bet.
Yeah, they make a little wager.
They make a little wager. They're going to race a car. They're going to go for a little race. And Fortsman's kind of asking about the DA and why the DA is not putting Harvey on the DuPont. Mm-hmm. That's a word I can't say.
DuPont. But it's not, there's no point. There's no I in there.
DuPont.
Yeah.
And why Cameron Dennis is taking the DuPont case and not Harvey. And Harvey's like, he's going to win. It's a slam dunk case. And Fortsman's like, great, you got the job. Because you're loyal to Cameron Dennis. That's not why he gave Harvey the job.
Mm-hmm.
It's not about the loyalty. It's about DuPont.
It's about DuPont.
Yes. So Harvey goes and he tells Donna that he is leaving the DA's office. And she tells him that Fortsman is super shady. She knows that he has rotten the cord, just like she knows that Harvey is a good man. And yes, Fortsman is rotten to the core.
And Harvey is a good man. Most of the time. I still love him.
I know. You and Donna.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Fortsman's a bad man because he made $100 million on a trade based on the DuPont information.
Yeah, I did.
That he got, the insider trade info. And Harvey is pissed. He's like, I'm not taking that money. And he goes, well, your brother took it. And he thinks it's from you. Because look at that check that I'm handing you. It's not $1 million. It's $850,000 because you told me the exact number that your brother needed. And I'm exploiting it. And I'm using your weaknesses and all your love to take advantage of you. You don't know that song?
You know, I do. I think it's done better as a solo, though.
Yeah.
I don't want to chime in because I was like, true. It's just hard to jump into it.
Yeah, the harmonies are hard on that one.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Donna's at Harvey's desk at the DA because he comes back after this moment. And she's like, I knew you'd be back because I'm Donna and I already took care of everything. I'm not just someone who's going to be a famous actor. I'm also not like every other secretary. And you're going to love vanilla in your coffee.
Yeah.
She knows everything. She's Donna-ing so hard.
Yeah.
Here we are in the present day.
Yep. There is a note from Lewis to Donna saying he needs her. And she goes into the office, and it turns out Norma is dead. If we could take a moment of silence for Norma.
I feel like I never even met her.
I know. We didn't meet her.
But I knew her so well.
Yeah, she was a freaking battle axe, according to Lewis. And she has left Lewis high and dry. And
so
she wanted her ashes to be left in the office with Lewis. So it's like, she was the Donna to Lewis.
She loved Lewis lit.
Yeah, she did. Yeah.
And he's just like, he's not processing it. He's just very mad.
No.
That he has to do so much paperwork.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Rachel is compiling a family tree for Woodall, and she's skipping school to do this because she wants to prove to Harvey that she is valuable and she wants to earn his respect. And I'm just like, okay, Lewis, okay. You want to earn Harvey's respect? You're so desperate for his respect. Yeah. What?
You said, okay, Lewis. You
are. Yeah, because I feel like Rachel's acting like a real Lewis here.
Oh, okay. I see what you're saying.
I'm making a comparison between the two characters. Okay. Yeah. Yeah, she's Rachel. It's like Rachel Litt is who it is, not Rachel Zane.
Okay, all right, I'll take that story.
Mm-hmm. It's Louise Litt. Mm-hmm. Louise Zane. Litt,
yeah. So we see Woodall, and he's buying lots of bread in a store. He claims that there is no money. Harvey has come to see him in the bread store. Harvey offers to represent him. He's like, hey, I think you're going to need me. And then he does something equally as hokey as when he put his freaking yearbook out. He hands Woodall a get-out-of-jail-free card from the game Monopoly. Don't get me wrong. Your girl loves Monopoly.
Your girl, Amanda, loves Monopoly.
But this is real cheesy. So it brings me to my first exposition of this episode. Did you ever play Monopoly?
I did.
And what are your preferred properties?
I'd always get the cheap ones that are right there if I could.
Okay.
And then Park Place.
Yeah.
You want to get those too. Mm-hmm. Like a nice variety of a portfolio. Mm-hmm. I will say playing Monopoly was not fun because my dad's a bankruptcy attorney.
Oh, okay.
And my mom is incredibly competitive.
Yeah.
So it was kind of like, you know, you're 7 years old and you're trying to make deals and they're just screwing you.
Yeah.
You know, they're just like, no. Be smarter with your money here. And you're just like, you know what I'm not ever going to do?
Yeah.
Go into commercial real estate because this is for the birds.
Yeah.
This is for the birds. I'm going to end up in jail or worse, foreclosed. What are your properties?
I get, well, Boardwalk and Park Place are nice, but I get the green ones and the red ones.
Magnolia.
No.
Isn't that one? The yellow ones.
Sometimes the yellow, but the green and red were always my lucky ones. I can't think of their names right now.
Mm-hmm.
It's been a bit.
Yeah, it's been a minute. Yeah. We should play.
Yeah. So, anyways, he gives him his get out of jail card because he's going to figure out what this money is. Mm-hmm. So then we go and we see Rachel and Mike, and they're making a chart, basically, of all the relationships, trying to come up with, like, a family tree-ish sort of like, all the people that Woodall could have close to him that would be impacted by this. So they decide they're both going to go and talk to Harvey about his shame, about something that happened 12 years ago, because they can't find anybody, so their pitch is like, you're going to have to go after Forsman for whatever he did for you 12 years ago.
Right, and I can tell how that's going to play out.
Yeah.
Donna comes to talk to Harvey about Norma, and he's like, oh no, I'm so sorry. And she's like, you hated Norma. And he's like, but I know Lewis liked her, maybe. And then she's like, oh, and by the way, you said you loved me. Did nothing happen, or did something happen? And Harvey says he only said he loves her because he wanted her to feel better, which I think is just something that slipped out. I don't think that's necessarily true.
Right.
But I think he did want her to feel better, but he also loves her.
Yeah.
And she's like, you know what? I don't want your pity.
Yeah.
He says, we have everything the way it is. It's everything that we need. And she goes, no, Harvey, you have everything. I don't want your pity. And she turns and walks away.
Yeah. Well, he goes, do you want everything? Like, really everything. Meaning, he said that. He's like, oh, do you want everything? Meaning, we could also be having sex.
I thought he said we have everything.
He does. And then she goes, no, you have everything. And then he goes, do you want everything? And she goes, what I don't know what I want, Harvey, but what I do know is I don't want your pity. So he was like asking her, like, oh, wait a minute.
Do you really want to do this? I didn't really understand.
Yes.
That.
Yes. Because she's like, I don't know, Harvey, if that's what I want, but I know I don't want your pity.
Yeah. So, but do you think he was like, oh, do you want me to love you? I didn't take it like that because it came out really snarky.
I took it as like, do we want to do this?
Really?
Yeah.
Okay. I guess his tone felt so like, you're idiot, kind of, or like, do you want everything? And not like, wait, Donna, do you want everything?
Yeah, I think he's got to work on his tone.
Which
is how I took it. I guess I could ask Carl.
Yeah, I think it was well delivered.
Sure.
Because it left us all wondering.
It did. Yeah. So then we see Lewis. He's shopping for urns. And he has Donna meet him there. He's like, hey, I don't want to get screwed by these people. I need you to be bad cop.
By the shyster dealer of death.
Yeah, shyster dealer of death. And I need you to be bad cop. And so Donna does not have to be the bad cop because Lewis is the worst cop. And he is furious and he's angry. And he starts yelling at Donna like she's normal. It's like, you didn't ever care about me. You just were worried about your sister. Like... He has...
Watching Golden Girls.
Yes.
And, we know Norma watches Golden Girls.
Yeah. And Donna's like, hey, Lewis, I'm not Norma. Goes over and hugs him. He's like, she was such a battle axe, but she was my battle axe, and now she's gone.
And he cries.
Yeah, he cries. He's really sad.
It's a very sweet moment.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, Rachel and Mike tell Harvey that what we talked about, like, he needs to go after him for the stuff that happened 12 years ago. But he's like, I'm not bringing in my brother. This gun to the head is different. I'm not gonna do it. So Rachel realizes in this debrief with Mike that her and Mike are the closest thing to each other. They know everything about each other. And they wouldn't show up on a family tree. So they need to think outside the box to find who Woodall is giving all this money to or where the money from enforcement is going. Also, then Mike's like, why doesn't Harvey respect you? Too soon.
Rachel's dealing with it. Because it's too soon for that joke. Yeah. Harvey and Cahill, they connect on the street. Cahill is going to get charged with harassment. If Woodall gets exonerated, he's going to be coming for Lewis Litt.
Right. Because Woodall thinks that Harvey was harassing him in the store with the get-out-of-jail card. Yeah. And Cahill's
like, maybe Harvey just needed bread.
Yeah, that's what Harvey says. And Cahill's like, you better solve this. So then Jessica's drinking by herself because Jeff's name just got scraped off the door. Harvey's like, hey, we got to talk about Marcus. I need you to get my mind right. And she goes, that's funny because Jeff just left and I don't even know how to get my mind right. She's a mess.
She's a mess, but like such a composed mess.
So composed.
God.
This is office mess, yeah, Jessica.
Office mess.
Then we see elegant Norma urn in Lewis's desk. That's where it has decided to live.
Yes.
Donna and Lewis are, again, talking about the situation. They both need a distraction. Lewis asks Donna to be his secretary because she's been his temp. And they're like, no, we're better as friends.
Yeah.
That's clear. There's no romantic interest, unlike Donna and Harvey.
Where it's just tension all the time.
All this tension.
Rachel and Mike confront Marianne McGrath.
Which
is kind of... You covered this because I fell asleep.
Did you fall asleep during this?
I mean, I know it happened, but like, I fell asleep.
Okay, so Rachel and Mike go to an Alzheimer's facility.
Yeah.
Like a care facility.
How do you say it?
Alzheimer's?
Oh, okay.
How do you say it?
Alzheimer's.
Is this another word that I say wrong?
Are you saying Alzheimer's?
Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's? Alzheimer's? Let me turn the volume up.
Okay.
Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's. What were you saying?
Alzheimer's?
And it's Alzheimer's.
Not here, it isn't. Like, literally, like, Think about like all the Alzheimer's.
Right there, Alzheimer's facilities.
Alzheimer's.
Hi. Mers. Alzheimer's. Alzheimer's.
Yeah, it's wrong. It's Alzheimer's. I'll get a lawyer on that.
I don't want to. I mean,
that's fine. We'll talk.
I don't want to keep the score here, but it is 2-for-2 for me. Amanda, here's the problem where we are regionally.
Uh-huh.
Is people say things different here than might necessarily be the correct pronunciation.
But how do we know that that person is saying it correctly?
Because this is a video, how to pronounce Alzheimer's.
But that person lives in a different place. So if I was recording it, I would be saying Alzheimer's. Hey, the law is up for interpretation. If I was recording it, I would be saying it a different way. That person lives in a different region. I don't trust it.
Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's.
So there's two different ways.
Mm-hmm. See?
Alzheimer's.
Now play the other one. She's from another country. Now play the other one.
Alzheimer's.
There you go. That's
so it's two different ways. Yeah. You cannot cut mine out and just put this one in.
Well, until you want to volunteer to edit the podcast. It only takes 3 to 5 hours per episode.
Okay. They're there to see Marion McGrath,
who has advanced Alzheimer's.
Alzheimer's.
Mm-hmm.
And she moved to the care facility 1.5 years ago, which before she was not getting very good care. This sucks because now they know that Fortsman's money is paying for Marion McGrath.
Yeah.
Who is Marion McGrath? She is Whittle's first wife.
Mm-hmm.
There's no proof. Like, there's no paper trail because it's all paid in advance. It's all paid in cash.
Yeah.
But Harvey tells Rachel she did a good job.
Yeah. Harvey goes to confront Whittle in a DVD store and he talks about Marianne. Like, he throws her name out. And so that does not make Whittle happy. And this made Whittle crack. And Harvey says, with me, look, it's my little brother. Like, I've had the same thing happen. And he was addicted to gambling. And for you, it's Marianne and she has early onset Alzheimer's. And Fortsman got us. You're going to have to turn him in. And if you don't do it in time for Cahill, like to hit Cahill's deadline, no problem. I got plenty of time. Harvey's like, I'll go after it.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not scared.
Yep. This is the first time that we've really seen Whittle crack,
mm-hmm.
too.
Yeah.
So we know.
Pretty cool.
We know mm-hmm. that Marianne is like
yeah.
a serious part of his life.
Yeah.
And that Harvey's close.
Uh-huh.
Then we see Lewis's eulogy about all the things he hates about Norma. He hates her clogs, her stupid seasonal sweaters,
mm-hmm.
how she used to be like such a hottie that mm-hmm. she got proposed to and it was the biggest mistake of her life. This gave me 10 Things I Hate About You vibe.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm. Good call.
Great movie.
Mm-hmm. Great movie.
Oh, my God. Heath Ledger was so hot in that mm-hmm. movie. What a moment.
Mm-hmm.
Don't let the moment pass is how Lewis ends this. Life slips by.
Mm-hmm.
And then he says, I love you, Norma. And then everyone just kind of leaves the office.
And you were laughing at this.
I was laughing at this because here Lewis has given this touching tribute to this woman who has passed away and been a part of the fabric of this firm
mm-hmm.
for a long time.
Mm-hmm.
And Lewis is clearly emotional. He's standing next to this urn
mm-hmm.
and people have just sat through this in his office. And now they just kind of like leave without acknowledging anything yeah. just happened.
Yeah.
Jessica's like, great tribute, Lewis.
And then walks back.
And then everyone just leaves.
Back to biz.
They're like, hey, I got stuff on my calendar. The only person who approaches him is Donna. And Lewis is like, I couldn't even see how I felt without you. Harvey has no idea how lucky he is to have her.
Mm-hmm.
And I think in this moment she realizes
that. She's like, maybe we'll find out.
Maybe you're right.
Yeah. So then Jessica walks by Jeff Malone's big old empty office. And she just keeps on walking. She grabs her coat and her big old black bag and gets on out of there. Fortsman, meanwhile, comes to check in with Harvey and remind him that Harvey can't beat him. And Fortsman says he's going to tell everyone that Harvey gave him a tip. And he basically confesses, like, where this money's going, how he's going to do it, and how Harvey's not going to win because they're not going to believe anything. And he's like, you can't beat me. And he's like, well, maybe actually I can. And then the SEC is there. Like, they come around the corner, Sean Cahill and crew, because Harvey's wearing a wire.
Oh, yeah.
Which is, like, crazy, right?
I love this.
Yes.
And they totally nabbed him. They totally got him for all the dirty things he did.
Mm-hmm.
And they take him out. They take out Fortsman. And then Cahill says, two for two to Harvey. Much like I said, two for two to you about lawyer and Alzheimer's.
And he had to take it back.
I did not.
That's tough. You did two for two, I mean, you were winning.
I think that's what Cahill means, and that's what I mean.
Do you think Cahill tied in this situation?
No.
Because you and I tied on Alzheimer's.
Wait, what do you think he means in this situation?
I don't know. I'm just talking about the fact that you referred two for two, and I'm thinking back to the fact we tied on Alzheimer's. So you wouldn't actually have won. You tied.
Yeah, I tied.
And you said that's similar to Cahill's. Like, what did Cahill tie?
Because Cahill's saying two for two to Harvey. He says you were right on, like, two for two things.
Mm-hmm. But he didn't tie anybody.
Yeah.
Are we tired? You just said two for two, and it's like Cahill said, but Cahill didn't tie.
No, he's talking about Harvey. Harvey.
Right, but you didn't win Alzheimer's. So, like, you're not like him.
I did win Alzheimer's.
No, because there's also an Alzheimer's. So we tied because there's two different ways to say it.
You're right.
I know. You're just saying that because you don't want to keep fighting.
Yeah, you're right.
But do you agree? There's two ways that we found already. It's true.
There are two ways.
Uh-huh. There could be more.
There's so many more ways.
There probably are.
You know what's crazy is there's infinite ways you can say things.
Uh-huh.
And who's to say what's right or wrong?
That's fair. It's all just a dream. Yeah.
I was going off, like, what the first thing is that pops up. But that's not always the only thing.
Yeah. Well, it's just the way you know from a certain region.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay, here's the one of the big moments.
That you laughed at.
That I laughed at. Okay. So Mike comes home and Rachel's in a gorgeous dress. She has set up candles. She has set up champagne. She is there to celebrate our win.
Mm-hmm.
So she has done so much work to create a romantic environment for Mike to walk in on. And then Mike comes in and he's like, hey, I'm going to propose to you.
In this environment that you've created.
Mike did no prep work. He called her daddy. He got Grammy's ring, but she, like, literally has created the romance for this moment. Yes. And Mike's just like, hi, I love you. This is Grammy's ring. She wore it every day for almost 60 years. Will you marry me?
Yeah, I mean, he was a little bit nicer than that. I mean, he said some other nice things.
I know. I was just laughing really hard that
she had done all the work.
All the work. Because how I would be celebrating our win would be like, hey, look, I'm wearing sweatpants.
And ordering Indian food.
And I ordered... Well, if it's our win, I ordered some Chinese food.
Sure.
You know, ordered some pizza.
Right.
And then I'd be like, oh, dang, I'm getting proposed to. And I look like a slob monster.
Yeah.
I'd probably have sauce all over my sweater.
She did all the work.
Thank goodness for Rachel.
She says yes. She's so excited.
She's going to wear that ring every day for almost 60 years, which makes me think about how I wear my ring every single day.
Mm-hmm.
But it's because my fingers have gotten so fat in this marriage that I cannot take my ring off of my finger.
Oh, really?
The skin has grown around it.
No, it hasn't.
It is stuck onto my finger. I have a small callus underneath it. I can't get this ring off of my finger.
What do you do about that?
I just keep it on my finger.
You never take it off?
I literally have never taken it off for the last, like, 5 years.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
What would happen if you needed to take it off?
Like, why?
Well, I think, like, surgeries and stuff like that.
Yeah, I would have to, like, stick my hand into an ice bucket, probably.
Mm-hmm. And shrink your hand.
And shrink my hand. Yeah. Or I'd have to have them surgically remove it.
Mm-hmm.
Because when I say, till death do us part.
You mean it.
I fucking mean it.
It's great.
Okay?
That's great.
Every day.
You sleep in it?
I cannot get this ring off of my finger. I cannot get it off.
Let me see some movement. Oh, yeah. I think it's on there.
It is stuck on there.
Is it uncomfortable?
No, I literally can't even remember what it feels like to not have it on my hand because I wear it. I've not taken it off.
I feel like it's probably uncomfortable. Maybe you need to get some soap on.
Oh, well, I still like try and clean it every once in a while. And I don't have like a ring line. But I get in there with a little Q-tip, try and clean in between.
Yeah.
You know?
I didn't know this. What's something new about you every time?
You know, I'm just full of mysteries. Harvey calls Marcus meanwhile.
Just to check on him.
Just to check in. And turns out everything is great. Mm-hmm. It was the second chance he needed. Mm-hmm. Kids are great. Family's great. Everything's great. Thanks for checking in. Gotta go. Then Donna walks in and we're like, cool. Harvey was right. Everything's good with Marcus. Don't really know what's going to happen with that money that Forceman gave him. Mm-hmm. This feels like it could be bad for their relationship. Donna walks in and something is bad for their relationship.
That money was given to them a while back. This money was given 6 years ago.
Yeah, so I guess he doesn't need to repay it or anything.
Yeah, I mean, like, Marcus has been fine since then.
He's been fine. Yeah. Okay, so everything's okay?
Well, I mean, I can't tell you that.
Yeah, okay. But Donna walks in and Harvey tells her that he does not pity her. It's kind of this, like, romantic moment where he's going on and then Donna interrupts him.
Yeah, because he's like, you're one of the most incredible women I think I've ever met in my entire life. And, like, he's about to gush.
On. Yeah. And she's like, I actually have to tell you I'm leaving you. For Lewis. And Harvey's face was just like,
gah! He tries to talk her out of it, and she's like, I love you, Harvey, which is like such a callback and a
such a boss move.
And he is like holding back tears at the very end.
She did it. She made him feel and acknowledge his feelings. Mm-hmm. And maybe he'll regret it. I hope he regrets it.
We're going to find out in season 5.
I hope so.
Well, we're going to find out something in season 5. It's been so fun. We're almost halfway done with this show.
I can't believe we are.
Can you believe that? Speaking of, people have acknowledged again how much they're enjoying the show, and I feel like we should read this review.
Yeah, we got a really nice review. Mm-hmm. This is on Apple. 5 stars. Perfection. No notes. From Yeti Jones.
Love that. Thank you, Yeti.
Yes. It says, I recently binged most of Suits and was thrilled to find such an awesome rewatch podcast. Well, I wish I had found it sooner so I could have been watching in real time with the episodes, but I'm glad I didn't because once I finish the series, I will be really sad and this will help. Normally when I listen to podcasts, I can hear things that I feel like would annoy some reviewers even if they don't personally bother me. This one has none of that and I can't wait to see it grow in popularity.
Oh my gosh, thank you, Yeti Jones.
Yeti Jones, thank you so much.
We can't wait to see it grow in popularity.
And I can't think of anything annoying we do either.
I can't either.
I literally am like, okay, singing?
Not annoying.
Not annoying.
Briefs?
Not annoying.
Taking a train down to Prediction Town?
Not annoying, but I will have to catch that train next episode.
Yeah, we're not even, the train is actually being repaired right now. Because Joe the whistleblower found a faulty sensor in it, and so.
I don't want to crash it, so I'm going to wait until next week for the predictions.
That's fair.
Bloopers.
Boxers and briefs.
Boxers and briefs.
Yep. So, boxers and briefies. Mm-hmm. So, if you're thinking, oh gosh, I'm not going to be able to make it without like predictions. What you can do, because this episode will come out on September 30th. The following day is the next volume of the Harvey Specter monthly newsletter.
Which is going to be so good.
It's so great. We've been cooking up some good stuff and... We have a very fall-ish, you're going to fall
kind of spooky.
You're going to fall in love with this volume of the Harvey Specter newsletter. It's going to come out tomorrow.
Yeah, make sure you're signed up at onlyseedsfans.com.
Yeah, and you can also go back and read the archives. So you'll be like, oh, I was so pissed I didn't get to read it then. But guess what? It's there. Thanks so much for tuning in. You can check us out at onlysuitsfans.com and you can follow us on Instagram, TikTok, and YouTube. You can listen to us on Apple, Spotify, or anywhere else you get your podcast. And don't forget to like, subscribe, and leave a review.
And if you're wondering, like, oh gosh, what will I start this review with? Why don't we take some inspiration from this episode and say, if I could give these gals a $1 million signing bonus with no strings attached, I would.
And that's the review. That's all you have to do. That's you don't even have to write any additional content.
Yeah. That's it. Yeah.
And if you do that, we will send you $1 million Monopoly dollars and a get-out-of-jail-free card. I got two turntables and a microphone.
But you have to email us to let us know that you wrote the review. It is a process, so you do have to work for that signing
bonus. We'll screenshot. Do it from your phone.
Yeah, just do it from your phone. Just do it. Screenshot it.
Comfort your toilet, wherever you are, you know?
Yeah. Just let me know who to send this money to. We did it.
We did it. See you next season.
Where's that? I got two devils of a micro.